Hello, friends. Let's sing Abide With Me. If you'd like to follow along or sing along, even better, you will find it on page 700 of the hymnal. We'll sing all five verses.
Good morning and welcome to worship. This is the fifth Sunday of Lent, the weirdest Lent I've ever experienced. I want to read to you from the Book of Worship, what the church historically has encouraged us to do during the season of Lent. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, the early Christians observed with great devotion the days of our Lord's passion and resurrection. And it became the custom of the church that before the Easter celebration, there should be a 40-day season of spiritual preparation. During this season, converts to the faith were prepared for holy baptism. It was also a time when persons who had committed serious sins and had separated themselves from the community of faith were reconciled by penitence and forgiveness and were restored to participation in the life of the church. In this way, the whole congregation was reminded of the mercy and forgiveness proclaimed in the gospel of Jesus Christ and of the need we all have to renew our faith. I invite you, therefore, in the name of the church, to observe a holy Lent by self-examination and repentance, by prayer, fasting, and self-denial, and by reading and meditating on God's holy word.
Herzog, lay speaker at the Napa Methodist Church, and I'll be bringing you the message today. In the season of Lent, our message theme and the daily devotion theme has been built around the word up. So far, we've heard store up and come up, take up, raise up, light up, and today, based on a phrase in the passage from John's Gospel that I'll be reading, it's lift up. The passage begins talking about some Greeks who want to see Jesus. These are visitors to Jerusalem. They're Gentiles, not Jews, but they want to be part of the Passover festival. They're friendly with Jesus' disciple, Philip. They're friendly enough to ask him for an introduction. Now among those who went up to worship at the festival were some Greeks. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and they said to him, "Sir, we wish to see Jesus." Philip went and told Andrew, and then Andrew and Philip went and told Jesus. And Jesus answered them, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls to the earth and dies, It remains just a single grain, but if it dies, it bears much fruit. Those who love their life lose it, and those who hate their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there will be my servant also. Whoever serves me, the Father will honor. Now my soul is troubled, and what should I say? Father, save me from this hour? No, it is for this reason that I've come to this hour. Father, glorify your name. Then a voice came from heaven. I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again. The crowd standing there heard it, and they thought that it was thunder. Others said, an angel has spoken to him. Jesus answered, this voice has come for your sake, not mine. Now is the judgment of this world. Now the ruler of this world will be driven out. And I, when I am lifted up from this earth, will draw all people to myself. He said this to indicate the kind of death he was to die. They say that there are three things that sensible people never talk about in polite society, and you know what those are: religion, sex, and politics. But I think they don't know what they're talking about, because we do talk about those things all the time. The problem is we just don't do it very well. We don't so much talk as enter into verbal combat, ready to defend our position against those misguided persons who just don't agree with us. There is, however, something that we really do not talk about, and that's death. We acknowledge death when it happens, but for the most part, we do not talk about death with any real substance, certainly not with enthusiasm. We don't deal with it, we deny it, we ignore it, we avoid it, because nobody wants to die. The death of our loved ones is too real and too painful. My son David is dead now 5 years, and Mary's sister and brother-in-law are no longer with us. Our own death is just too scary to contemplate. The relationships and parts of our lives that have died are too difficult. I'm sad to admit that I will never again walk all the way around Angel Island and then climb up Mount Livermore just for dessert. So for the most part, we avoid the topic of death and loss. Besides, it's a downer in a culture that mostly wants to be happy, to feel good, and avoid difficult realities. So there you are. I suspect the Greeks in today's gospel did not go expecting to talk about or even hear about death. They just wanted to see Jesus. They wanted to see him work a miracle. And that's quite reasonable. Jesus had been making a name for himself up to this point. He'd cleansed the temple, turned water into wine, healed a little boy, fed 5,000, given sight to the blind, and he raised Lazarus from the dead. I don't know specifically why those Greeks wanted to see Jesus, but I can understand the desire. We, too, want to see Jesus, and when we search the scriptures looking for him, we hear Jesus in John's gospel say, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified." But what is he talking about? We can only imagine the puzzled looks on the faces of Philip and Andrew and on those innocent Greeks who'd come to see Jesus do a miracle. And instead, they find a man who talks in riddles about farming. Nobody knows what he means, and maybe we don't know either. The conversation group that I'm part of was using the book Inspired by Rachel Held Evans to inspire our conversation before Lent. I very much admired her intelligence and her humor as she discussed serious matters. So I've been trying to read everything of hers I can get my hands on, and thank you, Amazon.com, for your help. Her first book is called Evolving Monkey Town. And in it, there's a story from a trip that she made to India with her sister. There she met Lakshmi, a Hindu HIV widow who converted to Christianity. And Lakshmi saw Jesus. It made me think of the Greeks in John's Gospel who came also to see Jesus. Rachel Held Evans describes it this way in her book. For Lakshmi, meeting Jesus had little to do with a transfer of information or a statement of belief, and everything to do with the outstretched hands offering food and shelter. In India, the gospel makes the most sense among the untouchables. So many Christians choose to live in the slums and leper colonies, to take in the HIV positive and the disabled, to give generously to the poor. They subject themselves to poverty and earn reputations for associating with the lowest castes. They remind me of Jesus, Rachel says. Lakshmi had said earlier, when I remember my life before HIV and compare it with how I am today, I'm thankful. Were it not for my HIV, I never would have met Jesus. I never would have found salvation and hope. Lakshmi had died to the old and been born anew. She died to caste and prejudice and came to new and abundant life in the Christian community. Seeds that Jesus had planted bore much fruit among the Christian believers. They were made up of native Indians who were helping to make the kingdom come. Jesus uses what seems to be a simple example. Unless a grain of wheat falls to the earth and dies, it remains a single grain. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. A grain of wheat has to die, and then it has to be buried in God's good earth. Otherwise, you don't get a harvest. Jesus was talking about his own death and his later resurrection, which would come just a few days later during this Passover feast that the Greeks and so many others had come to celebrate in Jerusalem. But he's also talking about the promise of eternal life for which he laid down a path. He is also, I think, talking about our dying to an old way and being reborn in him to a new and abundant life. Behold, I am making all things new. In Christ, we are a new creation. The Son of Man will fall and die back into the earth, an event so devastating that it threatens to turn all creation into chaos. But Jesus said that this is the hour which the Son of Man will be glorified, and we wonder at his meaning. The gospel wants us to find glory in this shocking event because in God's mighty agriculture, the death of Jesus will feed whole nations with the bread of life. Jesus' body, sown like a single seed into the earth, will send its roots down and its stalk up until it bursts from the ground with power to feed the hungry souls of the world. To get bread, you have to thresh some wheat, separate the edible grain from the chaff. To get wine, you have to crush some grapes. To get a new life in union with Jesus Christ, the old life has to be completely demolished and buried. We join in the sweet, mystic sweet communion, dying to an old life to find abundant life in a new one. Grains of wheat, that's what we are. Through a death, however it comes, we can become the bread of life. Unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies. The old is gone, the new has come. Trust in God. From the prophet Jeremiah, we hear, "The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah." From Paul to the church at Corinth, "Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creature. The old things passed away. Behold, new things have come." And finally, from the Revelation, "He who sits on the throne has said, Behold, I am making all things new." So there is death and there is resurrection. And God will lift you up on angel wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of God's hand. Amen.
Good morning. As I did last week, the song I've chosen for this morning comes from our Lenten devotional scripture for this coming week, and as a response to our communal need to be lifted up. A special thanks to Holly Zacconi and all of the contributors. This booklet has been especially meaningful during this time of isolation. From whence does my help come? sense. From whence does my help come? I lift up mine eyes unto the mountains. From whence does my help come? My help cometh from the Lord, maker of the heavens and the earth. My help cometh from the Lord, maker of the heavens and the earth. I lift up mine eyes unto the mountains. From whence does my help come? I lift up mine eyes unto the mountains. From whence does my help come? My help cometh from the Lord, maker of the heavens and the earth. My help cometh from the Lord, maker of the heavens and the earth. Now this time, sing with me. There's only two lines. First line is, I lift up mine eyes unto the mountains. From whence does my help come? Second line, and each line repeats two times. Second line is, my help cometh from the Lord, maker of the heavens and the earth. Here we go. I lift up mine eyes unto the mountains. From whence does my help come? I lift up mine eyes unto the mountains. From whence does my help come? My help cometh from the Lord, maker of the heavens and the earth. My help cometh from the Lord, maker of the heavens and the earth. I lift up mine eyes unto the mountains. From whence does my help come? I lift up mine eyes unto the mountains. From whence does my help come? My help cometh from the Lord, maker of the heavens and the earth. My help cometh from the Lord, maker of the heavens and the earth.
This morning's time of prayer is coming from the sanctuary. I'm standing next to the window of Jesus the Good Shepherd, who holds the one lamb, the troubled lamb, the wandering lamb in his arms. Because this story reminds us that all of us are precious and irreplaceable to God. I invite us in this time of prayer to think about how we are in prayer. I'm praying more than I probably ever have before. I know I'm the professional prayer, the one who encourages other people to pray and talks about the importance of prayer. And I too often say I'm just too busy to do that this morning, or I'll do it before I fall asleep. But I've been praying, sometimes walking, sometimes reading the Psalms, sometimes with colored pencils in my hand, sometimes in silence, sometimes on the phone with you. How is it with your soul is a question that John Wesley asked the first Methodists, and it is a question we can ask ourselves and each other. Let's start with joys, remembering that as citizens of the world, we are invited to take part in the U.S. Census, and if you haven't done that, please do it today. Every night we have a bedtime story on Facebook. I'm hoping they'll soon be on the website as well, and that is just an amazing joy and delight to see the different people and hear the different voices who are reading stories to us. We are people of the story, lest we think that bedtime stories are just for children. I'm standing in front of the great storyteller, Jesus, who told stories to capture people's minds and hearts and imaginations. Please remember those in our community who are suffering illness, fear, loneliness, alienation. There are many people. And again, please reach out to people in the congregation and in the community and ask them, How is it with your soul? We give thanks for everyone who's helping us do worship online. Matt Wagner and Don Hitchcock are only two of them, and they've just been amazing gifts to our congregation and to the staff. I invite us now into a time of confession and pardon. My brothers and sisters, Christ shows us his love by becoming a humble servant. Let us draw near to God and confess our sin in the truth of God's Spirit. Most merciful God, we, your church, confess that often our spirit has not been that of Christ. Where we have failed to love one another as he loves us, where we have pledged loyalty to him with our lips and then betrayed, deserted, or denied him, forgive us, we pray. And by your Spirit, make us faithful in every time of trial. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now hear these words of pardon and assurance. Who is in a position to condemn? Only Christ. But Christ suffered and died for us, was raised from the dead and ascended on high for us, and continues to intercede for us. Believe the good news. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. And now, with the confidence as children of God, let us pray together the prayer Jesus has taught us. Our wondrous one who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. This is a time in our worship service when we'd be given the invitation to give our tithes and offerings. And even though we're not together, we still need to give. It's innately who we are as human beings. It's innately who we are as a Christian community. We give. I invite you this week to send your tithe and offering to the church, or to go online to our website and make an electronic gift. I invite you as well to find other ways to give in our community, to find out who needs you, who needs what you have, and how you might give it. I offer this prayer of dedication for all that we give. We dedicate these gifts freely given and gratefully received to the work of this congregation here in our community and in the world, building honest, caring relationships across all lines of difference, growing in spirit and searching for meaning together and apart, promoting religious freedom, practicing compassion, and working for justice. May these gifts and the work of our hands and hearts give power to all we stand for as a community of faith. We pray this in the name of the one who has given us everything, God Almighty. Amen. Thank you.
Hi, it's Michael again, and I want to leave you with some good words. I do not possess the gift of prophecy, so I can't tell you what the week to come is going to be like. I suspect it'll contain too much information and not enough information. Our children will be bored and the adults will be anxious, except when the children are anxious and the adults are bored. Our children are experiencing distance learning. I think we will have to learn distance loving. So keep your distance. Do the right thing and keep a lid on it, because everything's gonna be all right. All will be well. And try to remember that God will lift you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you safe in the palm of God's hand. May you go now in peace, and may the peace of Christ go with you. Amen.